Dutch National Center for Cybersecurity. And I'm going to talk to you today about threat intelligence or threat information from the perspective of a CERT. And I'm not going to give this talk to you for a blueprint or an instruction on how to do CTI. I just want to give you some inspiration on, and thoughts for you to take home about the dissemination of cyber threat intelligence. First, I'm going to give you the contents of my presentation so that you know what you're going to deal with today. First, I'm going to talk a little bit on the challenge of CTI for national search. And then I'm going to explain to you our National Detection Network, or NDN. And finally, I'm going to explain how the knowledge of the NDN translates to different products that we make and to our portfolio. And finally, I'm going to touch upon some future challenges that we face and some lessons learned. But first, let me introduce our organization to you. No? It's a little bit soon. Well, doesn't seem to be working. But we are the Dutch National Cybersecurity Center. We are the Dutch CERT, or Computer Emergency Response Team, or CCERT. Our tasks include monitoring incidents, incident response, giving warnings to our constituency about vulnerabilities or threats, and also to act as a digital fire department in case of a national crisis. And we consist of approximately 200 people, and whereas 14 of them are assigned to our CTI team. And our constituency now is mainly governmental parties and parties in the vital infrastructure. Still going too soon. And today I'm going to talk to you about CTI from the perspective of a CERT. And something weird is going on with CTI and CERT. Because as many of you know, the first rule of CTI is to work from a very clear information requirement. Because if you have a very clear information requirement, the details on to your threat information are going to be very actionable, it's going to be more specific. So how more specific your information requirement is, how more specific your answer is going to be. And for instance, if you as an organization is targeted by criminals, then you know what kind of sources you're going to look for. Then you know what that you have to look to underground fora or the underground market to see if criminal organizations mention your name. But as a CERT, you have a problem because your information requirements is not targeted at all. It's very wide, it is very big, and you have to deal with the information requirements for a whole constituency. For instance, you and your threat information have going to serve the governmental organizations, you are going to serve organizations that make up the critical infrastructure, like ISACs, you are going to serve other communities, other CERTs within your country, and other parties in your regional ecosystem. And it is very logical that, for instance, the Ministry of Defense would like to know the latest information on a cyber threat espionage campaign or an APT that's relevant to them. And it's also very logical that the universities want to have the latest information on ransomware campaigns. So you serve each party that has the information needed that is relevant to them. And not only the abundance of affiliated parties is a challenge, but not all organizations are the same. They're different in their levels of maturity. A couple of years ago, we did an inventorization, and we made this subdivision of parties within our constituency, like entrant, practitioner, professional. And this allows us to monitor the growth of maturity of organizations. And we do not try to aim our products at a specific level, but to use this subdivision allows us to see what products fit organizations most and where our value lies. Here are some examples of questions we get from parties in our constituency. And you see that they are very diverse. There are examples of technical questions, which mostly have to do on indicators of compromise, on detection. And I'm going to talk more about detection later, by the way. But there are also very tactical questions who deal more with threat actor groups, trends, modus operandi. And there are also very organization-specific or applied questions. And I show you these examples because they illustrate the diversity of the information requirements that you have to deal with as a national cert. And because of this, I want to show you this picture. It's probably very familiar to the most of you. It's the circle of threat levels Center of Critical Infrastructure Protection in the UK. And it shows the different levels of threat information. For instance, you have the tactical level, and it deals mostly with threat actor groups, modus operandi, trends and developments. The technical part deals more with more technically detailed information, for instance, like malicious domain names or IPs or hashes. You have the strategical part. That's part that board of directors use, for instance, to derive the policy from. And you have the operational part. And this part deals with more acute threat information, almost incident response kind of information. And also, this circle shows you that you, as a national cert, are expected to provide information on each level. And because you have to provide information on each level, we have organized our team roughly accordingly to this threat circle of CP&I. In our team, there are technical specialists, and they have a technical background. They're people who look at threats from a very technical point of view, who do the detection and monitoring at the NCSC. And we have people with a more diverse background, our threat analysts. And they're people not so much with a technical background, but more diverse kind of studies. They, studied criminology or security studies, or intelligence studies. And I think the diversity in your team, in your threat intelligence team, is very important because it helps you to look to threat information from different perspectives. And it helps you to avoid tunnel vision in your investigations. I think that the combination between the technical and the tactical part in your threat intelligence team is very important. I think it's key because you don't reach your objectives with only technical data only. You can detect malicious hashes or IPs, but it's not worth much if you can't provide it with the tactical context that goes with it. And the same goes another way around. So I can give you information on the latest ransomware campaign, but it is not worth very much if I can't provide you with the technical details that accompany it for you to use for your monitoring and detection. And I think these specializations working together give you a much more complete threat landscape. They complete your threat products on different levels. And besides, it's very motivating and inspiring for people in the team to work with different specializations to look to threats from different perspectives. So, we as the NCSC, as a national cert, rely on different sources. We rely on open sources, of course, but also closed sources. We work closely together with intelligence services. And we buy in commercial sources, but we also use our National Detection Network, or NDN, as a source. Our National Detection Network is deployed in governmental organizations, but also in organizations that make up our critical infrastructure. And it consists of a mechanism to deploy and to share indicators of compromise and other threat information to organizations within our constituency with the objective of monitoring and detection. It kind of works like this. So we as an NCSC, we collect different sources of threat information and then we enrich it with our own data and with our other relevant data. And then finally, we share it in the form of a feed, an intel feed, or other intelligence products to our participants of the NDN, who use this to, for monitoring and detection. And if one of these participants see a hit or a sighting, they share information back to us so that we can share it in our turn to other participants who can use it for monitoring detection. So that an incident at one party becomes a warning for all other parties. And for this goal, we have placed different sensors in organizations in the governmental sector. Because of fair market competition, we have only placed sensors there. We can't place sensors at parties that make up our critical infrastructure. But those parties, they receive our threat intel feed so that they can choose how to implement it themselves. Our technical specialists collect our threat intel info on our threat intel platform. We used MISP for this, and actually we still use MISP for the threat intel feed that goes to the parties that make up the critical infrastructure, but for the other parties, the parties who use a sensor, central government, we use the threat intel platform from Eclectic IQ, because this platform allows us to relate observables more directly and to connect entities so that we can discover connections between threats. And this platform is used by specialists as well as our threat analysts. And although we label each threat according to likelihood or to impact or relevancy, organizations who receive our threat intel feed still have to interpret it as raw data, because not every indicator is relevant for each party, of course. They still have to distill the relevant info to them that they can use for their own organization. And organizations mostly don't use our feed alone. They have different feeds. They buy in commercial feeds or very specialized feeds that is available to their sector. But our feed that focuses on threats relevant to the Netherlands, it completes their information position. People sometimes ask me what the false positive ratio for my feed is. And I think although it's very important that you look daily towards improving the quality of your feed, to filter out bad indicators or to filter out unreliable sources, I don't think the false positive ratio says much about the value of your end result. I don't measure my false positive ratio because of roughly two reasons. And the first reason is that organizations receive our feed as raw info. So indicator that can lead to a false positive result at one organization can lead to a legitimate sighting at another. And the second reason is that it doesn't automatically mean that your feed is worthless if you have false positives in them, because it can mean that IOCs were simply not malicious in a certain time frame, or that your firewall blocked it. And I think these two examples show that you can still help organizations with your analysis and your conclusions, even though that sightings may not mean that an actual compromise is going on. This is a report that is written by one of our technical specialists. It's for NDN participants. It's very technically detailed. And it's often derived from things we observe in our national detection network. But this is just one of our products. We write other things as well, which I want to show you. I want to take a short look into our portfolio. Oh, here it is. For instance, this is a report or a simple email that our threat analysts write to organizations if they find something that they have to warn them about, a certain development or a threat. And these kind of reports can be very customized. They can only be written to the energy sector, for instance, or they can be very generic for all NDN participants or just for a whole constituency. And we always try to give the organizations the information that's relevant to them. But I have to honestly say, we do get a lot of criticism for it, because organizations say to us, who are you to determine what's relevant to us? Just give us everything. But as a national cert, you have to keep a balance. You don't want to overflow organizations with irrelevant information, because this can cause alert fatigue. So you do have to gain a balance into providing organizations with relevant information, not to withhold it from them, but also not to overflow them with them. This is a very generic report. This is called our monthly monitor, and it's not detailed at all. It's just two pages with the most relevant cybersecurity developments that happened this month for the Netherlands. And organizations use this to keep themselves informed, or just to inform their management about developments that deserve priority. Sorry, I just skipped to the end there. I'm not used to this. But here we were. Yeah. The next thing I want to show you about is our threat analysis report, our quarterly threat analysis. And this is a much more detailed report than our monthly monitor. This this reports on trends in digital threats that we see. And it is rich with technical data, and it's enriched with malware statistics. And we also translate it in English for international partners. And it is relevant for technical specialists, as well as analysts and people at the CIO level. And I would like to point out one example from this quarterly threat analysis. These are the digital trends that we saw in the times of the COVID pandemic. We wrote a little bit about it, and it was about fraudulent apps we saw, DDoS attacks, attacks on the healthcare sector. So I think this is a very unique product, because as a national cert, we make it non-commercially and really focused on really important threats that are relevant to the Netherlands. Another thing that our analysts make are threat-based scenarios. We facilitate these exercises at organizations where we plot the likelihood of digital attacks against networks and systems that they own. So we get this overview, this matrix of likelihood of digital attacks. And from this matrix, we derive scenarios. And organizations use these scenarios for red teaming, for exercises, or to give them an argument towards the management to prioritize certain security measures. And finally, we deliver input in the Cybersecurity Assessment Netherlands. This is a yearly report, very strategical. It's made by our Dutch National Coordinator of Terrorism and Safety. And it's used by boards, but also our policymakers to gain insights in trends and to use this to formulate policy. And finally, if you plot these products, these threat products that we make, onto the circle of threat levels that I've shown before, then you can see all products can globally be aligned to one of the quarters. And this illustrates our goal as a national cert to provide information on all levels. But like I said before, this talk is not meant to give you an instruction and not to give you a blueprint on how to do CTI as a cert. Because we face our own challenges. And I think the first two one is not strange for anybody. I mean, everybody struggles with funding, capacity, lack of people. And the increasing of encryption on the internet, like DOH and DOT, are making our national detection network, that's mostly signature-based, less effective as a security measurement, like does cloud-based traffic. And also, to get parties to share their info back towards us remains a challenge. And this is not so much a trust issue, as well as that it takes effort, and not all organizations have that kind of capacity. Finally, I want to show you some lessons learned that I learned in my time as a team leader on cyber threat intelligence. I want to share them with you. First, combine your technical team with your tactical team to cover the complete threat landscape, because you get much more complete products and you work with a much more complete threat landscape. The second is trust is essential for CTI to mature. It takes trust for parties to trust a national cert and vice versa to get your information towards and back to keep it flowing. And the third one is false positives are not automatically a waste of time. I think you can put organizations at ease with your own analysis and your own conclusions, even though the sighting might not actually lead to the finding of a compromised system. And for national search, it's difficult to choose commercial feeds. And that's a thing. You have many of good products on the market, very good CTI products, but some are very specialized in one sector or one region. And as a cert, it's almost impossible to choose. So you have to find out again and again what kinds of commercial sources are most useful to you. And the last one is a product manager. It's useful for assessing the impact of your product. And that's about evaluation. I think it is very necessary to evaluate your products, evaluate what you do for your constituency. Because if I hear that, for instance, our monthly monitor is useless for our constituency, then I would rather take my team and effort to do other products, to make better product for them. So I hope this overview gave you some interesting thoughts on the dissemination of CTI to take home with you, and I hope I could give you some inspiration today. Thanks very much for your attendance and for your attention, and thanks very much for the organization for the excellent facilitation. Thanks.